The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition by one of the young talents coming out of the northeast of Scotland. Shock and horror, I'm doing a WrestleZone-centric episode of the podcast, but I'm speaking to young Connor Molloy. Welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me on. It's great to have a wee chat.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it, especially after, of course, I messaged you probably the day or 2 days after the Halloween hijinks show, so I was like, right, that's it. Screw Vago. I'm getting in all the WrestleZone guys he hasn't had for single episodes yet. I'm just going to message them all and see what I got. I'm trying to rearrange ones for other people, but I'm like, no, let's get Connor on after his appearance at the Mosh Pit. I'm sure we've got plenty to speak about. But the first question is always the same. We'll just get that one out of the way. It's the classic. How'd you get into wrestling? What was the moment that got you hooked as a fan?
So I have no recollection of, like, you know, people remember their first time watching wrestling, or I remember this match that I just seen it on TV or whatever. I don't remember, like, the first time I seen wrestling. I just always remember from my childhood watching wrestling, like, with my younger cousin or just growing up. But I remember, like, I always watched it, but then, like, it was, what was it? I think I'd stopped watching it for a wee bit or something. I borrowed from my mate, I borrowed the 2010 Royal Rumble DVD, and I think I hadn't seen wrestling for a wee while. I was 10 then. Or something, and I think I watched that like 6 times in a row. I just kept on watching it, and because like when I was younger as well, Shawn Michaels was always my favorite, and then I don't like that his story to going up to Undertaker at WrestleMania 26. That really was what got me like properly hooked. Was like the first like story I was like so invested in. It's a shame that this eventually got really hooked into Shawn Michaels just as he retired.
Of course, typical. 2010, what have I got in my head? It's Sheamus, that's wrong.
No, that's Edge, yeah.
Of course, when you're saying Shawn Michaels, I was like, that's Edge, it must be Edge's year, but I was, yeah, now I'm just curious. It was 2012, of course. Yeah. Right. Anyway, moving on. So Shawn Michaels being your first like proper favourite then, and like you say, 2 months later, once you got back into it, he was gone.
Yeah,
was there anyone else in that first little bit that kind of caught your eye as you're a fan of?
Jeff Hardy, Rey Mysterio, all the classics that everyone loved from about then, you know, just watching them fly about off stupid things and stuff was just always Jeff as well. Like when I was younger, Jeff was just right up there in terms of one of my favorites. It still is.
Absolutely, and Jeff Hardy is, it's no secret, he's one of my favourites as well, and he seems to be, as people, I would say my age, but you're a lot younger than I am, but as people like, for my generation and upwards, Jeff Hardy still seems to... Yeah.
He's just like universal, everyone just loves him. I don't think a single person could hate Jeff Hardy.
Yeah, I mean, even, he's one of those weird things, he's done very bad stuff in his own personal life, which was transpired into his ring work. But even then, people are just like, that's Jeff Hardy. I love Jeff Hardy.
Yeah.
I definitely see, I don't know if I said it in the podcast with Kelly, but I did say that to her at the time that I was seeing when you came back at Halloween Hijinks, there was definitely a Jeff Hardy influence somewhere in there. I don't know if it was a young 96 Jeff Hardy when he was getting beaten up by Razor Ramon, or if it was something else, but there was something there that I was getting a vibe of.
I'll happily be compared to a young Jeff Hardy. That's fine.
just maybe not so much the ladder stuff just yet.
We'll see. If I got the option, sure.
Yeah. So why not? And WrestleZone have certainly thrown in some great ladder matches over the years. So. You're gonna have to just get next level of that, and which could be bad or good depending on if I'm watching it'll be good. If you're doing it, might not be so. So how did you get from that watching it? So 2010 is when you started watching it again. When do you decide to think, right, I'm just gonna give it a go?
So yeah, I never, like, it's always like, you know, you watch it and you're like, oh, it would be cool to do. But I never even, like, when I was growing up, I wasn't like, oh, I really want to be a wrestler. I was like, I loved wrestling, but just didn't like think, you know, like growing up in a tiny little town in the northeast of Scotland, you don't really think, oh, I can go do that. But it was just like, I was 17. I just left school. And it was like the summer after leaving school, I wasn't really doing anything. And I must have just been watching wrestling. I was like, you know what? I might as well give it a try, see where the nearest wrestling school is, go try it. If it doesn't work or that, at least I've tried. And I searched up the nearest wrestling school. I was really hoping there was going to be one in Inverness. Of course not. So Aberdeen, the closest one, and just a nice like 2-hour drive to get to it. Or I couldn't even drive it when I first, for the first year, so it was the train and back.
Oh, Christ. I know it's weird Elgin to Aberdeen itself, it seems like the train never arrives, and it's always like, oh, next stop, oh no, Dice, forgot Dice, next one. But yeah, so that's quite a big risk to take then. So going from Forest to Aberdeen and the train, just to give it a go. Were you aware of WrestleZone before you searched up the new school? Did you see any independent wrestling at all?
I have still never been to a show. I haven't still never seen wrestling live that is not WrestleZone yet.
Wow. Okay.
I've never been to see wrestling in person before starting, and I still haven't went anywhere else to watch it yet.
So pretty much all your actual experience with seeing guys like Gredo or that is all WrestleZone.
Yeah.
Okay.
100%.
That's interesting then, because when we see all these guys coming in, when they have the likes of Jack Jester coming through and stuff like that, you're just like, oh, you're a wrestler too. Cool.
I mean, of course, you like see everything online, but.
But you know, that didn't actually go to, what would have been round about Forest? Rock and Wrestle, I think, did a couple shows there. That's about it. W3L comes to Elgin once a year. That would be your only options, really, outside of going all the way to Aberdeen.
I'm just not much for going to, like, concerts or anything. Just, I don't know, maybe I'm just too lazy to go anywhere. But I just don't tend to go out and watch things.
Of course, for those that have seen the Mosh Pit appearance, you don't listen to music.
I listen to music, I just don't listen to bands. Which Ryan still tells me I do listen to bands and that I'm wrong. But
Ryan has no right to judge, he has not seen any movies. So, I mean,
Ryan gets probably like a lot of stick for not having seen movies, but I have probably seen just as few movies. I am not a movie watcher at all. Like, if I'm watching with other people and someone sticks a movie on, it's fine. But me, like, I can't physically sit myself down and watch a movie for like 2 hours. I just can't do it.
And then the scary question is after that, what do you do? outside of wrestling.
Outside of wrestling. I love football. Terrible at football, but love football. So watch a lot of football. Got to the gym a lot. Since the start of the summer, watch a lot of YouTube, drink a lot, not as much as last year when there was nothing else to do and me and all my flatmates were stuck in at halls just drinking like a ridiculous amount because there was nothing else to do.
But that's the thing, when people start, I mean, people ask myself, so what do you do outside of wrestling stuff and watch Marvel films? Nothing really. I've got a dog.
I miss my dogs. I don't watch films, but I do watch the Marvel films. Like, I feel like I've seen most of them, of all of them. I am behind right now. Like, I've not seen Captain Winter Soldier, Loki, Shang-Chi, but I'm desperate to go watch Spider-Man when that comes out. So I'll catch up before then. Spider-Man ones are my favorite ones.
I'm catching up on the Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield ones at the moment in the lead up.
That's a good point. I should rewatch them.
There's some ropey CGI for early 2000s.
In my head, it's probably like, oh, it's still amazing. So I've not seen them in years, but
yeah, that's what I thought. Because I was watching the first one and I was like, oh, I remember this being amazing. I loved it because Spider-Man. I love Spider-Man.
Yeah,
and I was watching it going, oh, it's a bit ropey with them. You can see it's pretty much like a pasted picture of Spider-Man just getting dragged across the screen. I was like, oh, that's not great. But But yeah, Spider-Man's the best anyway. But no, it's the TV shows and the ones you're kind of behind in Black Widow and Shang-Chi and all the newer stuff.
I've seen Black Widow though, so I slotted that one in. So, but the two shows and Shang-Chi I'll need to catch up on.
Plenty of time. It's just Eternals out next month. Take loads of time.
Oh god, yeah, I forgot about that one too.
No, I keep forgetting it is coming out. I'm going to try and arrange to go because it has to be Aberdeen Inverness for the cinema because Elgin's shockingly bad.
It is terrible, yeah.
I went to see the Suicide Squad in Cinema 3. You probably won't be aware of Cinema 3 because it's awful, but it's just a room. It's no bigger than this room, I would say.
I think I know what you're talking about, because I think for something when I was younger, we had that room like private rented out, and it's only got like 10 seats in it or something, like it's tiny. Yeah, I can't remember what we're watching, but I remember falling asleep in it.
It was a very awkward experience because I was the only person that came on my own. So everyone else had couples, and there I was just on my own watching the Suicide Squad with my mask on and just couldn't hear anything because our sound system's awful. If anyone is listening or watching this from the Murray Playhouse, get your sound in order. It's awful.
I remember them having not been in years and years, but I always remember them having particularly terrible popcorn as well in Elgin.
Yeah, it's like they've got the offcuts from they went to the bins and at the View in Inverness, and they're just like, I'll do, that's ours, we'll just go up the road.
Honestly, probably.
Yeah, probably, yeah. I wouldn't be surprised. Anyway, right, so we're on to, so you've taken the train 2 hours up to WrestleZone in Aberdeen, and of course, I mean, nowadays, they give out the address, you know where the training academy is. When I started watching WrestleZone, it was like, I don't know where this mystical training academy was, like it was a scout hut possibly. So when you sent that message off, was it just come on through? Were you given anything kind of to do to prepare, or was it just a case of just here's the address, come through?
I think there was like a little like questionnaire sort of thing, like that you had to like give answers to see if you were like suitable to attend, I guess, and just like basic questions about you. But then, yeah, they just, I think, just sent the address and were like, come along. And I think I kept putting it off because I was quite nervous. I think I put it off for a couple of weeks and I think it was Blue Thunder. I kept emailing back and I was like, I'll be there next week. So I was just a little bit apprehensive because I didn't really know Aberdeen either. I've probably only been here a couple times, like ever, and probably not by myself. When I was 17, I was like, oh, Mum, I'm going through Aberdeen to start wrestling with a bunch of people that I've never met. And she's like, oh, that sounds terrifying. Yeah, go do that.
Aberdeen's the big city. It's the big city you go to.
Compared to Forest, yeah.
Oh, I mean, I grew up in Rothes and Elgin was the big city. Aberdeen's a different world entirely. So that may explain some of the questions about you being late, but we'll probably get onto that a little bit later on. So first time, 17, you're coming into the training academy. Blue Thunder's no doubt there. I like to imagine he's always doing the training, coaching in the mask, because it'll spoil the magic for me otherwise.
Oh, he definitely does, yeah.
Of course. So you've got Blue Thunder there, you've got probably Scotty, I'm guessing, so just a couple of the guys. You've never seen them wrestle, outside of looking on Facebook and going, oh, there's a guy with a mask. Yeah. What was that first day like then? I was
petrified. Like, because you walk in and it's just like this long hallway and there's like, there used to be like two different training rooms, but I walked in and I was just like, just stood at the front door for like 10 minutes and just didn't see anyone. I was like, I don't know what to do. Do I go through? I was too scared to go through. And then I remember the first person that I seen like just walk through was Caleb Valhalla. And I was like, oh my God, this man is a god. He'd only just started training I think 1 week exactly before me. And I literally just looked at him and I was like, he must be their champion. Like, I was like, he must have been doing this for 10 years. He just looks amazing. But eventually, I think he was the first person that I spoke to. And then eventually I think we'd speak to Scotty and that. And I think the first time I just watched my first session, and immediately I was just like, you know, I'd never seen a wrestling. That was the first time I'd seen wrestling. It was that, and it was just like, okay, I need to come back immediately. It's the next day if possible to do this. Just watching people take bumps in the ring and doing flips and rolls and all that stuff. And I was like, oh, this just looks fun. I just need to come back.
And so outside of that, you say you like football, you you say you weren't good at it, but you played it. So there's a little bit of a foundation for like kind of stamina at least. Did you do anything else? Like, I don't know, because you're quite high flying and slender as well. Was there anything like gymnastics? Any?
So when I was younger, I did a lot of that, like dance and street dance and that sort of stuff, which actually has, I was speaking to Mr. P about this like only a few weeks ago. It really helped actually. Like flip bumps and everything, you know, from just like doing front flips and stuff and like nip ups and all that stuff, like, and just footwork in general. I think it really helped without meaning to. It was just like just a good foundation of like footwork and all that sort of stuff, and not rhythm. Rhythm sounds like wrestling is dancing. It's not, but just getting your body in more in tune with itself, I guess.
That was, and as soon as I said dancing, that was my first thought, was your footwork, your rhythm. Because I mean, for a lot of things, especially things like, this is coming from someone who's never done it, who's always stepped in the ring to do ring announce twice, of course, you've got like five steps turn to try you run the ropes and things like that, depending on size of the ring. So it's all about getting that rhythm going and being able to get into it if you're starting halfway or what have you. So it definitely is, it seems to be quite a good thing to have on board. So I'm just imagining all these big burly wrestlers like Caleb Valhalla just doing a little bit of dancing in spare time just to get the old footwork going. That's funny. Like, the first guy you see is, I would say at the time, would have been literally the exact opposite of you. you're coming in quite small and what have you, and then you look up and see, like you say, a god.
Yeah, literally, a god amongst us boys.
When I saw him the first time, I was just like, why is this guy not wrestling everywhere? Because he looks amazing. Even then, he probably wasn't the best wrestler at the time when I first saw him, but I was like, nah, that guy's a wrestler. I'd put him everywhere. So you came back. Of course, I'm going to guess you knew at this point wrestling wasn't real. And it's an art form. We'll say that. It's an art form.
Yeah.
Because from everything that I've read and seen, it does hurt. But what was it like getting that first bump in then?
It was all right. The bumps, bumps and rolls that were, I think, again, from like that, when I was dancing when I was younger, they came like quite natural. I mean, bumps don't come naturally because you're literally doing everything against what your body is telling you to do. But for the most part, they were quite all right. Like the physical stuff would come quite quickly. It was more everything else, like the mental aspect of it was much, much slower than like doing bumps and everything.
So was that like putting together a match or trying to interwork a crowd?
Yeah, just crowd work and even just like positioning and all that sort of stuff. Just every like thing that isn't the physical stuff was a lot harder, and still is work in progress, of course.
I mean, especially when you're coming in with, I mean, at the time, still pretty much the wrestling guys are all a bit bigger. You'd be surprised at how big some of the guys are, especially Crusher Crabe, which again, another person will definitely get onto. It's coming in there. Was there anyone in your kind of class outside of Caleb starting the week before that are still about, anyone like that?
No, there was quite a good group of us that started, but then around that time, but I don't know, there's no one that's still there from that like month or so, like that we had like a good group just over, like, even I think just over the year, everyone just seemingly dropped out one by one. Seems to happen, like, the last few years I've seen, you know, like a lot of group will start and then like maybe if like a group of like six people, like one will stay, you know, after like a year or something, because most people just come for a few months and then seem to decide that's not for them, which is fair enough because it's not for everyone.
I think the good thing as well when it comes to wrestling, again, from what I've seen and read, that they don't rush you into the ring. When I'm speaking to some of these other guys that have been wrestling for years, they were thrown in after 4 months and didn't know what they were doing, and it was a terrifying experience. But whereas it seems to be wrestling, you at least a year before you're even, or just about a year before you'd even thought of going into a show.
Even
MEC's guys debut, they're very rough around the edges, but couple of months on shows with a crowd, that's I'm done, because that was the bit that was left.
Yeah,
you're on the job training.
No, it's definitely a lot of time in preparation before, you know. I don't think I've seen anyone like be thrown in before they were ready or anything. It's always, you know, even if they didn't think they were ready, but the trainers knew they were. So,
absolutely, yeah. And I think, I don't know if it's a case of, because you hear about the get a good group in, you see the pictures on the Training Academy and Facebook, and you're like, that's a good group of guys. The girls and guys that all look great. Could be, if they're in ring shape and they could be good with the crowd, they could, that's your next generation. And then next week it'll be, or next month it'll be 2 years left. And it's just like, oh, yeah, okay.
It's strange how that happens.
I don't know if people just go in and go, right, I've ran the ropes, I could throw myself on my back, just get me the ring, I can do the rest, don't you worry about it. And then being told that, no, we've got to at least train you for a year before you're going to be
there certainly is some people who need to be told to slow down. And because some people will come in and will be like, oh, what to do, put a power bomb and a spine buster, and it's like, you haven't learned how to bump yet, so...
Was there any moment that you had of that when, because you're traveling 2 hours on a train, well, one way, and then 2 hours back, for that time, and that's a lot of traveling, and it's not cheap either, because you got that, and then you got to pay for your training as well.
Yeah.
Did you ever have a moment where you're like, you know what, I don't think I want this that much, or was it always just gonna go, that's it?
From the first session, I was like, all right, this is what I'm going to be doing for a good while, anyways. And I remember I was like, just so even, like, I was so hooked. Like, the second I started, I was like, just like, oh, this is just amazing. I remember I was like, even the first time I like couldn't make a training session, I was like devastated. I was like, how dare you be? I just missed the train. I was just late, because I am quite known for running late in just all aspects of life. But I missed the train. I was literally just like, I just walked back to my house and I was just so sad. I was like, I'm going to miss something tonight. They're going to do something fun and I'm going to miss it. I'm just going to, you know, just miss out on just getting better for that night. It's just like, so annoying.
That'll be the one you go the next week and they're like, oh, I should have seen it. So-and-so did this massive 480 somehow splash. And you're like, oh, I should have seen it. So we're at your debut then, or we're not at your debut yet, because technically you weren't supposed to debut in our eyes anyway.
Yeah.
It was January 2019, which I couldn't believe it was only 2019. It feels like you've wrestled a lot longer because of that weird 2020 missing bit that's kind of skewed life. You were open challenge, from what I remember, Summer Hall Showdown. So one of their big one of their regular venues for WrestleZone. And you're up against, you know, easy start, Crusher Crabe.
Yeah.
What was it like being told that, right, were you doing a lot of security beforehand so people could get to know your face a little bit, or was that just your first night you're in?
I'd been on security for some shows, but not a lot, just from virtue of being all the way in Forest. And I was, at the time, I had to work every second weekend anyway, so if it was fitting into that, then I was on security. But not like, I'd been at some shows, but not like a huge amount, like not like as many as I should have been, to probably to me helping out more for, like, you know, when you're training, you should be at a lot of shows helping out. And just, I probably wasn't as many as I should have been, but no, it was certainly an interesting start to my wrestling career.
Yeah, so you came in and you accepted, or did you accept, or were you just give, you're told you're accepting
the challenge? I think he just told me. I was he just pointed at me when I was like standing at the back of the room at the merch table, and it was good. It was easy though, because they were like, just act petrified, and I was like, I don't need to act. I will be petrified.
Did you have much discussion with Crusher beforehand? Because I know from my chat with him and of course with Vago, who's going to get so many plugs tonight, that his head will be humongous. He'll be like a pumpkin. So he'll be, Crusher's not the easiest to crack. You've got to kind of know, he needs to know that you're sticking around before you'll let you in. So were you in by that point because you were traveling all this way and showing your dedication, or was it still a little bit standoffish, a little bit?
I don't think by that point you would have been standoffish. I'd been at training with him at times and like chatted to him, so we were like, I knew him a wee bit, but like I wouldn't say we had chatted an awful lot before Summerhill Showdown. But it, on the day, was, you know, great and very helpful and everything that you could you would want.
Have you seen Terminator? Just out of curiosity.
I have not.
Does he know that?
I don't know. Probably. Movies and me just don't go. I just can't.
You get yourself and Ryan on and just do the worst movie quiz ever. I think that would be.
I would get zero.
I don't think Ryan would do much better. So maybe just
I generally would like to do a movie quiz with him to see which one of us actually like knows the least, because I don't think there's much in it.
So first match in, and from what I read afterwards, because I wasn't at the show, was this crowd just took to you, and WrestleZone crowd, they love wrestling. They just want to have someone they can support. And of course, Crusher was being the big baddie at that point. He was I think he was unpinned since he came back September prior, so that was he was pretty much on a tear. And of course, you weren't so lucky that night.
No.
But how did it feel getting that first bit of action in the ring in front of a crowd?
Oh, it was amazing. It was, the adrenaline that I got was just unbelievable. Like our whole thing, like I think the match was 4 or 5 minutes maybe, but it flew by, and it felt absolutely amazing. And the crowd did really take to me, which was absolutely lovely. And as soon as, like, I think I got help to the back by whoever was working on security, because Crusher had killed me pretty much. But as soon as we got backstage, I was just like, I want to do that again. I was just like, I could feel like the hair on my arms was tingling. I was just, my whole body just felt like butterflies. I was like, that was great. That was so much fun. And it was pretty much only supposed to be a one and done, you know, just like a first wee introduction for me onto shows, you know, have them just like squash me basically with me getting a tiny bit in, and then see wherever I can fit in on shows down the line. But because the crowd were so into what we had done, by the time I'd came backstage, they'd already planned the next year. They'd planned from January to December for what we were going to do. And I was like, all right, that's a bit of a change, but I'm sure.
Let me check my shifts.
I was very quickly like, all right, Nate, book off this. I think all my holidays went that year on just booking off like Saturdays for shows.
And in the first, like, it didn't come on cage match, but you were in the Rumble that year as well, weren't you?
I was, yeah.
Yes, you were. That's fine. Yeah. Great. Again, this whole 2020 being missing, it's through my timeline off as well, because I was at that Regal Rumble, because of course is the one where Mr. Malice died, as everyone knows. Yeah.
The thud backstage was ridiculous. Like, I could feel it through my feet all the way backstage. Even watching it now, like, I seen it not long ago, and I just shivered like that.
The fact that he came back, I'm still in awe of. But
yeah, I wouldn't have taken that, suffice to say.
Of course. So this is the first time I would have seen you. Not that's important to anyone's story, but it is to me. I would have read about your match with Crusher at Summerhill Showdown. I would have seen bits and pieces here and there of training and photos and what have you. But also on the WrestleZone page, not a creepy way. You come in. And then you, if I remember rightly, you eliminate Crusher. And the place went nuts about it. And it's that whole, I don't know if you were told to watch any Maven Undertaker stuff at all.
No, I know the spot you're talking about though in the Rumble, but no, yeah.
So that was, yeah, you knew then at that point, like, that this is going to be the story. Because even, like I said, first time seeing you, I'm like, oh, there's something here between this and the crowd were behind it, and that's always the important thing when it comes to wrestling, especially. You could probably be a little rough around the edges wrestling wise, but if the crowd have got behind you, then
definitely, yeah.
You can get the rest of it as you go along. So again, you had this moment in the Rumble. I don't know who you got to interact with during the match. I can't remember, but there was plenty of experienced names in that match anyway that you could have had a minute or
Caleb
two with.
Also killed me in that match as well. Just absolutely planted me through the ring, and that was me pretty much done. And then I got thrown out, so I didn't get killed quite as hard as Mr. Malice, but it was still fairly sore.
Yeah, and of course he was quite. I think that would have been one of his first proper appearances as well. So yeah, you may be a bit excited and threw you a little bit harder than you possibly anticipated, but nature of the beast, isn't it? I suppose in the whole swing of things. So when you heard the reactions though when Crusher went out and everyone just went absolutely crazy, went banana. What were you like? I mean, the sound of it, you love wrestling anyway. So it wasn't like you're going to be, oh, I love this. This is amazing. But it's like, you're like, the story is going to be amazing. If they've already set out your year path, you're like, I've got them at this point. It's just a case of just keeping that momentum going.
No, I did not expect like them to still be as, when they said, oh, we're going to do this year thing, I was like, they're not going to care for a full year. They're not going to remember like this little squash match in January. But no, but like when it was like the Rumble and he eliminated him and he went out and the crowd went wild, I was like, oh, okay, yeah, it is going to be something. And it was great. I was so nervous because he had me up for like a powerbomb and ranted him over the top, I guess. And then I think we'd done it like once in training, but I was just like, I'm so scared I'm going to fall and just eliminate both of us. So I like held on the rope with like dear life. I was like, there's no way I'm falling out. But I remember like I almost like forgot to react at all to him being eliminated. That I eliminated him. I think it was, I might be remembering this wrong, but I think it was Johnny Lyons that literally like gave me a shove like after I eliminated him. He was like, I can't remember what he said, but he was just like giving me a wee nudge just to like do something. And I was like, okay, thanks. Yeah. Just that, because I probably just dropped out of it for a second. I was like, just after the crowd went wild, I was like, well, that happened.
If I know anything about Johnny Lyons, it was probably expletive laden, and but would have been from a good place. And then I was going through the rest of your match from that point. Actually, no, your next appearance would have been Abrianica that year, but not as a wrestler. Yeah. So this this is why I love the storytelling in WrestleZone, because. Like I said, the only time I would have seen you before was this Regal Rumble. So that's all I'm working from. The crowd went nuts, so there's something there, definitely. So Crusher was against Bingo Balance and Lionheart, for those that are unaware. And towards the end of the match, you pop out. No, that's not right. Crusher attacked you during the match.
During his entrance.
Of course.
Walked around the ring, and I was like sitting at ringside for security, and I can't remember. He just battered me basically, and threw me about. accidentally threw me into Brian, who was doing the photography, and he still gives me stick for that, for flying into him. It wasn't my fault. And then he threw me in the ring post, and then I was away to the back for the majority of the match until. Until I had to come out and get my revenge, essentially.
That's where we're at. So at that point, Crusher turned the previous September. He'd been unpinned. The only time he'd pinned would be outside of WrestleZone by Lionheart in Aberdeen, of all places. But it was outside of WrestleZone, so it doesn't count. And you come back out, flying forearm later, and Crusher is pinned for the first time since then.
Yeah, that's the best flying forearm I've ever hit. I hit them quite often. I'm like, I just don't think I'll ever be able to hit it. It was perfect. Maybe it's just the adrenaline of it being anarchy, but I was just like, that was picture perfect. And the crowd went wild, so it was great.
And you wouldn't have had to do any wrestling beforehand to actually gear up to do it. It was your only job other than knocking out Brian, the photographer, which will grow arms and legs as every time it's being told them. So, you know, did he have a hairline fracture by a year later? And I was injured for weeks afterwards. So again, another big moment. So every time you've been in the ring at that point, the crowd just went absolutely nuts for you because it's been this humongous moments of interacting with Crusher.
All these story beats that we were building up to,
Absolutely. And so when you were told kind of like the layout of the year and what have you, were you able to kind of put in a little bit of input going, oh, what if we do this year? Or were you just at that point, you're too brand new, just go, I will do what you say, tell me to do.
Yeah, I was just like, what are we doing? Sounds great. Okay, can't wait. No, I was just, because everything that they said was sounding great. Anyway, not that I would have suggested anything otherwise, but at that point, maybe now I would have. But no, I was just happy with going along with what they had planned, and everything went quite well, so I'm happy with it.
So you got here, your first like official match was a tag bout with Scotty Swift against the Outfit. So that was kind of, again, this little beat of you showing what you can do in the ring before actually the big showdown with Crusher, the Battle of the Nations. So I was like in the ring with Swift because he's just, it's weird because you've been coming in at this point with loads of like crowd going nuts for you, just accepting you, excited to see you. And then you go in with Swift who will do all he can to pull all that stuff he gets and put it onto you.
Oh, you don't
need it at that point particularly. But what was it like getting to work with Swift and against the team of the Outfit?
Oh, it's great. Yeah, me and Swift have teamed together a couple times now on shows, and it's been great every time. Probably the most nervous I'd been up to that point, like having like first official match. I was just like, okay, they actually do well at this, but it was fine. I was actually like, even not now, I'm fine with it now, but when I first started, entrances, hated doing entrances. It was the most nervous part for me, and I was actually really glad because that match started with a brawl. Like during our entrance, the Outfit jumped us, and it was good. It made it so much easier because I just stopped thinking and just started punching essentially.
You haven't fallen to the trap of the come ons and the hand claps just yet.
Hand claps, no. The come ons, there was a period of just coming out and just going, come on.
It's weird. It seems to be like a bugbear for a lot of people, and I didn't notice it until someone pointed it out that it was annoying. I was like, oh, they all do it.
Yeah,
they all do it now. So as far as gear was at that point, did you have your gear done? When did you get that kind of arranged and made?
I think I was supposed to have it for that show, but I probably just hadn't emailed them back in time. It was probably my fault. So I didn't have, I had some very funky, essentially like yoga pants essentially, which were used for that, which done the job for one show, I guess. They were a certain interesting choice, but they were better than nothing, I guess.
I'm assuming this wasn't the TikTok fad ones that are a bit hugging the right places kind of thing.
No.
That's fine. So your gear itself, though, as soon as I saw it, it reminded me of pretty much something you'd see in 2K, whatever, WWE game. It looked very much, it was designed on there, one of those games. But was there any particular thought behind colours and the design, or did you just saw it, liked it?
Just wanted something not too basic, but just kind of clean and simple-ish looking. Purple's my favorite color, so I was like purple, and I was specifically told by just about everyone, they were like, just don't get black, everyone wears black, not really at wrestling as much, but like just in general, you know, everyone just wears black. They were like, just try and get some color. I was like, because you would wear some color. I'm like, yeah, I would. So purple and white was what we went with.
White's a brave choice.
Yeah, that was not the best decision. The gear's fine. The boots, I have white boots, and they're just like first match scuffed. I was like, great. It's like, I don't know why I got white boots as well, because we're kick pads and kick pad covers, so I could have just wore black boots and they would have been covered up by the kick pad covers. But
every time now I see Nathan North was particularly brave with his choice of gear, because he had a whole like white garb, and I was like, that's one show.
There was one of the trainees just now was just talking about ordering gear for the first time, and he was like, oh, I'm getting this and getting white boots. And I wasn't even in the conversation. I was just like, don't get white boots. You'll regret it, I promise.
heard that yellow is partly in our bad color for boots, just for the exact same reason. They just coat everything.
Just makes sense, yeah.
Just get black. Yeah. We won't judge. I won't judge you for black. Just it'd be fine.
I'm thinking as well. Like when we have to do like galas, and if I've got to like walk on grass with the boots on, I'm like, that's just going to be awful.
So of course this leads up to Battle of the Nations, which will be the next time I would have seen you. I went to a lot of shows that year, I'm now realizing. So Battle of the Nations, you were against Crusher Crave. This was the big one, the rematch from January, and you got the win, which is again another humongous moment. But what was it like going into were you nervous, as nervous as you were when you're teaming with Swift? Were you as nervous the first time? Or by that point, you interacted with Crusher enough, you're like, we'll just do what we do and it'll be
Yeah, because we'd done quite a few things on like other smaller shows where he like would like attack me, and well, usually he would attack me. That was pretty much it. just in various different ways. But no, I feel like every single time I'd get more nervous. But I probably was pretty nervous again just going into that match. But you know, we talked through everything, and came up with, you know, a pretty good structure and everything. So by the time we were actually going out, you know, it was starting to, I started like perfectly subdued myself, and then as soon as I went out the curtain, I did do the massive "come on," which I hate. I just like I had more adrenaline running through me than I think I've ever felt before, and I was just screaming at the top of my lungs.
What was the point where you realised that way back in January, when you're like, oh, they've given this whole year, I'm not sure if they'll actually, the crowd will keep it up for the whole year. Was it around about this point you're like, oh, okay, they might, because this would have been, what, six, yeah, 8 months in at this point?
Yeah, considering it being like 7-8 months like between matches, like, it was like, oh, they still do care, even though we've only been doing little bits here and there together, so... Yeah.
Your next couple matches, there's some interesting ones.
I don't even know what was next after that.
Oh, you got some interesting ones. So we've got Tariff against Dino, which I'm assuming you won it, but I'm sure a forearm was somewhere there and about from Dino. We've got Balmedi. This is September still, against Caleb. So
we've got two great matches back to back. They were.
And again, two wins. So it's really much this underdog thing of just against two very large individuals in different ways.
The Caleb one was a DQ win because Crusher came out and attacked me. But I'll still claim him as the first person to beat him in wrestlers one. So
still counts. Still counts on that. So. Yeah. So when it came to like working as an underdog, because you're against these bigger guys, were you kind of sent away to watch anyone in particular, or do you just go, right, Rey Mysterio did that well, Jeff Hardy did that amazingly, Spike Dudley, was there anyone that you were kind of told to by Blue Thunder or Swift or what have you to go, right, go check out this guy's work and bring it into your character?
Fighting from beneath and all that stuff, I would watch a lot of Michaels just because he's just good at everything, but so a lot of him. They don't specific, like they'll tell you just like, you know, watch this and this for certain things if you ask and that, but they won't like give you home. Well, I was about to say they won't give you homework. Blue Thunder has definitely given me homework before, as to go watch stuff, because I've just, even wrestling, it's just I've just the lack of, they get annoyed whenever I say I've not seen X, Y, and Z matches or shows or just whole companies and years of stuff that I've not seen. But nothing, they don't, not like 100% particular stuff to watch, but definitely did watch a lot of, or do watch a lot of Michaels, just to see him fighting from beneath, because he's just great.
Absolutely, like was it SummerSlam 2002 being one, him and Triple H, and the injured back, and all that kind of jazz, so yeah, there's play, I mean, you could pretty much do a lot of, unless you're big into submissions, but you could pretty much do everything off of Shawn Michaels watching his matches anyway.
Yeah, because definitely up until that point, all my matches had been against much larger people than me. Most of my matches still have been against much larger people than me, but Dino and Caleb especially were, you know, a lot lot bigger than me.
So before Halloween Hijinks 2019 Crusher, you had a match in Inverurie with our favourite, the Super Executioner, which must have been absolutely a different pace for you, because at this point you're again fighting from underneath, you're against bigger guys, you're in a fairly intense storyline with Crusher, and now you're in the ring with Super Executioner, which
yeah, that was certainly a different sort of match. It was the first time I'd had to do like anything besides just, you know, getting beat up and try to fight from beneath and try to do like comedy and stuff. If I had that match now, I'd be much more confident and I could actually enjoy it. I don't think I'd done as well as, you know, because I just wasn't ready to just like fully like let go and just like not be afraid to act a fool if needed. Which that match, a match against Super Executioner, kind of needs you to have just let go and have fun essentially. But it was all right. It was for what it was, yeah.
I suppose when you're doing dancing and what have you, you're not so much street dancing. You are kind of interacting with an audience, but you're not so much focusing on them. You're kind of focusing on your moves, which you would be doing in the ring as well. So how did you find actually getting the crowd involved, other than of course telling them to come on when you come out? But how did you find trying to get the crowd interacting? Did you have confidence beforehand, or was there a moment that the light switched? Was it the Super Executioner match? You're like, all right, okay, this is how you bring in a crowd.
I don't think around that time I had particularly anywhere near any good crowd work. I don't think I felt confident in front of a crowd properly until the Halloween Hijinks that we just had. Like, even all the I could have a match back then and come back and be like, oh, I enjoyed that. Like, after the fact, if I watch it back, I'd be like, oh, that was quite, well, I'd never really be, it was like quite a harsh critic but on myself, but I'd be like, okay, that was okay. But never like actually had I enjoyed performing in the moment until like the show that we just had. And I don't know if it was all the time off and I'd been missing it, or just because it'd been like such a long time, like just changing and growing as a person, that I was just like able to fully let go and really enjoy myself while we were out there. But back then, definitely wasn't able to like enjoy myself. So I was probably like, you know, too closed in to myself at times to really be able to do like effective crowd work. Whereas now I feel more confident, I can probably try and bring the crowd in a bit more.
Well, you definitely showed that a couple of weeks back. When this goes out, it'll be like a month or something like that. I don't know. Again, I'm still not recovered from the timeline. all wonky. But so, yeah, it's a weird thing of letting go, because really, for that time, that 2 hours, 3 hours, the people that are ringside, they're just all in to see some wrestling. And then after the show's over, that's your characters. You're done. I'm sure there's still folk that are sitting outside waiting for you to come out and get a picture or an autograph or what have you, because there is plenty of regulars that still do that.
Oh yeah.
I unfortunately not a lot of them, because I just get fed up and just go home, because I've got to go back to Elgin. So yeah. I'm just like, no, it's 10 o'clock, I'm going home. I'll that's always the awkward thing about shows. Like, I want to speak to everyone afterwards, but I'm like, what am I going to say? I was like, good show, all right, cool. Can I get an autograph? But yeah, so of course this still added beats to your Crusher story. You had no contest with Ryan Riley, and I've written down Sterling. I'm assuming it was William Sterling.
Yeah.
In Huntley, which is a bit closer to home.
I didn't even remember that was a no contest. I remember the match. I just didn't remember the finish until you just said that.
Right, hang on. I'm calling calling cage match into doubt here. So let's just double check, because I'm a big nerd. I have all these results as well on my own. Triple threat. Oh yeah, Crusher Crabe. There he is.
Yeah.
No contest due to Crusher Crabe. So he's still quite angry with your two pinfall wins.
He's still angry now, even when we're a team. He's still angry at me.
So he had that. So again, every match, bar maybe the Executioner one, there's still Crusher looming. Newton Hill, November. It was a team with Damien. So team with Damien for the first time. That's much like teaming with Swift. How it was like teaming with someone who's very much established in WrestleZone.
It was really good. Yeah, he's great, of course. And that match was really fun. But I probably didn't have any input. Just for the other guys that were in it, they were. But the just even backstage, the ideas that were getting banded about was just. Like the match was absolutely ridiculous, but that was it absolutely 10 times toned down from like this just stupid stuff that they'd already included. But I remember at one point like Caleb carried Alan Sterling pretty much the entire length of the hallway just to like carried dropkick into it, and we moved out the way and it was into Crusher, and it was a point where I was on Damien's shoulders and Alan was on Crusher's shoulders, and we were wrestling on top of each other's shoulders. It was just a really fun match.
That also kind of helped getting you out of your comfort zone a little bit more.
Yeah, I was just about to say that. Yeah, that probably, I still wasn't fully confident, but that match probably was more fun. That was probably the most fun I'd had to that point during a match.
And this all leads to Christmas Chaos, where it's just where your rivalry with Crusher ends. Of course, your story of Crusher is still ongoing. Of course, it's a Christmas brawl.
Yeah,
we've got here. So we'll get into the match in a sec. But so you started January that year.
Yeah,
you wrestled in Summerhill, which is again one of the regular venues. Is that the one that was shut recently? No, I can't remember. Cloverleaf was the one that was shut. Summerhill Showdown. So again, big one. Regal Rumble, huge event at Northern Hotel, Avenue Anarchy, Beach Leisure Centre. Battle of the Nations, which would be Northern Hotel again. So you've been on the Big Five, the Big Five shows in your first year, in a highlight, like a big program. Outside of that would have been Damien's title challenge and all the stuff going around about that. So you're probably in the biggest story, and the Joy Lions stuff as well. I don't know how to even ask a question, but it's like, how did you feel that was your first year? And you probably had the best rookie year in WrestleZone, I would definitely say.
It was great, to be honest. To like, I feel like I would have been much more nervous I was already nervous, but if like I went into, just having debut match, cold match just against anyone, and then you're just having like a series of like cold matches, just no story or anything leading into it, that's much harder. So the fact that we had a story was, for me, it made it so much easier mentally. It's like to wrap my head around it instead of just we're having match. I couldn't have asked for a better first year, to be honest, in terms of what we did.
Yeah, I can see what you're saying, because there is maybe one or two names I could think of that have made their debut but they haven't had a story yet. So it's like, they're just having matches, so
yeah,
there's nothing to kind of gravitate towards. But yeah, absolutely, you came in, hit the ground running, and certainly grabbed every opportunity. So Christmas Brawl comes, which is, I didn't get to that one, that's a shame. So there was Christmas items are legal. I don't know what was used. Was there anything that you were able to put forward wrapped in tinsel? Was Mickey Vago there going, see, if you wrap it in tinsel, it makes it legal, it's a Christmas item? Because Vago is very good at skirting these rules that come about. But so Christmas Brawl, how was that?
That was a lot of fun, yeah, because at the Halloween show, we'd had a match, I'd beat him, and then he came and attacked me with a steel chair, which was fun. I'd rather not relive that for a while. So that set up the Christmas match, and that was, I think that was because we got like longer for that match as well, because it was a big payoff to the year. We'd been building up this for a full 12 months, and it was a lot of fun to do. I did have just like the kendo just with a little bit of tinsel on it to make it Christmassy, and we were just going like, because obviously the Christmas show, everything's set up for Christmas anyway, so it's like everything that's around, pretty much, not even like just the stuff we brought, but everything around we can use. And I remember like just like midway through the match, like some like teenage girls were just screaming at me to throw the Christmas trees on him. So I just thought, like, he was on the ground, so I was just throwing the Christmas trees on him. We had these, like, massive boxes, like Christmas present boxes. And Christian was just like, oh, we can do something with him. He was like, I'll superplex you through them. I was like, I'm never taking a superplex. He's like, you'll be fine. I was like, great, okay. I remember midway through the match, like, I think he stacked, like, he ended up stacked, like, eight of them. And then, like, he went to go turn to the suplex, and then he was like, they're way too high. Like, we would have been, like they were, we would have landed, like, midway through them. So he just pushed some of them off. But that was a lot of fun. Got some great photos of that match as well, like, just after I land, my face just... That match was a blast to do.
I don't want to dwell on the chair too much, but so that would have been your first proper in the ring stuff outside of being battered and thrown about, but this would have been your first kind of plunder and weapons kind of thing. How comfortable were you swinging weapons and hitting Crusher? Was he beforehand going, like you said, I'll be fine? I just, like, was he on board for you just swinging things as hard as you can, or were you a bit more gentle?
Well, I probably would have been a bit apprehensive if I hadn't the show, like, before taking the chair shot from him, the multiple chair shots from him, because I think it was like the week before the show or something. I think it was to Blue Thunder, I said, I'm kind of curious as to what the chair shot's going to feel like. I'm a bit nervous. And he's like, oh, you'll have the adrenaline that going through you. But if you want, I can hit you with it just now so you know how it'll feel. And I was like, all right, we'd just finished training. I was like, yeah, okay, sure, why not? And then he hit me. And I was like, oh, it wasn't pleasant, but I can deal with that. He's like, well, he probably won't hit you much harder than that. Jesus Christ. I mean, Crusher on the day did say, he's like, you know, to make it look real, I've got to, you know, really go into you. I was like, okay, but, you know, Blue Thunder said it won't be much harder than that, so I was like, oh, it's all right. And it was just after the match, he'd given me the big boot, gone and got the chair, and I was like, okay, here it comes. The first one, I was like, oh my god, because Crusher, absolutely massive, and he put every single fiber of his being into every single one of those shots. It was three, and then I was getting back up, and I was like, just holding on the ropes to get back up, and probably real. I was just dragging myself up. And then on the fourth one, I was like half stood up, and he absolutely leathered the last one. And I can't even describe the noise. It wasn't even selling. It was just air and noise left my body, and I could not even try and make that noise if I tried.
So before the bell rang and you had a weapon in your hand, it would be PTSD flashback going, oh, this is my turn.
Yeah.
So that would have been probably one of the most hardest hitting matches you would have had at that point in your
tournaments. Oh, yes. Yeah, definitely. I got to get my own back when he was like crawling around the outskirts of the ring, and I had a kendo stick just whacking him, and then just got to really let him. He like stopped at one point. He was like, then just leather me into my back, and I was like, great, sure.
If you insist.
As long as I was hitting, like, you know, straight on his back, I wasn't worried about not up here or anything.
Safely, but you were maybe adding a little bit more juice than you may have done before the chair shots.
We had like just stupid stuff in that match. We had he sprayed in my eyes like fake snow and stuff like that. I was going for a dive, and just midway through, he just sprayed me. I had like a bag of Christmas baubles that I put down on the mat, and then he ended up giving me a choke bomb onto them, which actually didn't feel that bad. I was like, this is going to be really sore. And then it was sore, but not like as bad as I thought. But he pinned me off it. I kicked out, and I was like on my front, and I didn't realize what it was at the time because I was like face down. He was just like sat like on the ground as well, just grabbing baubles and just smashing them into my back. I was like, ow. Then I watched it back and I was like, oh, that's what you're doing. That's why it was sore.
I'm going to say, because if you're looking for plastic ones, maybe not so much, but you get those glass ones that can properly hurt. Probably I've watched Home Alone. That's my basis. My basis is on this.
That's a film I've seen. That's what I've seen.
There we go. I've got one. And of course, end with the handshake. That's your year done, job done, and it's all done. He did a Christmas video with Crusher, which I loved because it was ridiculous.
I think we've done three videos around that time, which were fun.
There was something.
The one in the one at the Christmas fair was terrifying to film. Filming in public was certainly interesting.
Awesome. So all this stuff, all these little like videos, again, trying to get your character out as well and getting that confidence out of you somehow. Filming in public in Aberdeen. Oh, I'm assuming it was in Aberdeen, isn't most. It's a weird place, Aberdeen. It's like nobody looks at each other, but when they do, there's this weird moment of, oh my god, with my eyes, this is so awkward, this is horrible. And then you're out with a massive. So someone, Kyle described it recently as a boy and his dad.
Yeah,
and. And that's how it kind of comes across as well. He's like, the boy and his dad. So what was it like getting, you said it was terrifying. What was it like actually just getting that, doing all those kind of little videos and were you able to share them out to people? Did you get any reactions from your friends, from your family? What was their kind of thoughts on these things?
they certainly found it interesting because they were just like, why were you doing that in public? I was just like, it was just part of the story, just what we had to do. It was like, it was fine when I was like, you know, we were getting filmed and it was fine when I was like saying whatever I was saying, but then, you know, we had like Crusher stood next to like Santa or reindeer just being like, what is this? So that then people were just like, what the hell is this man doing? You know, because I'm just going around this Christmas fair just describing everything to him and he's just screaming that he has no idea what anything is. So people like family and kids were just looking at us like, what the hell are these people doing?
In the back of your mind, you're going, I have to come here next week to do my Christmas shopping. They'll know me. Those weird things. And then, of course, Summerhill arrived. It's again, team with Squift. Sorry, Scotty Squift. You end up teaming with Crusher and Montrose and win the tag team titles. So,
yeah.
It's been a weird 11 months. one of the more intense storylines of WrestleZone, and then coming out of it with a belt.
Not how I was expecting my first year or so to go at all. But
when you were approached to win a belt, of course, because Thunder and Sterling had just won it that Christmas Chaos, retiring Johnny Lyons, so it was a big match, big emotional thing. And then 2 months later, you guys come out and win the belts and celebrate Christmas every day. So what was it like being approached, being told, right, okay, you've done great this year, we're going to put a belt on you and you get a team of Crusher. Was there one hand going, great, I get a team of Crusher again, or you wanted to maybe do something just without Crusher for a bit because you spent the whole year with him? What was your kind of initial thoughts being told you get the belt?
It was certainly strange. It's just like, you know, wasn't expecting to win anything that soon. I was happy to still be doing stuff for Crusher because, you know, maybe if we were still doing like, you know, a singles feud at that point, it'd be like, okay, it's going on a bit long. But because it, you know, transitioned into, you know, tag, because I'd only had, what, two tag matches on shows by that point. So to like be thinking, okay, we're going to switch gears and it's going to be like, tag team wrestling you're going to be doing that, it's like, okay, because even in training, like, hadn't had enough tag matches at all, and even still now, not as much now, but they're still definitely, like, you know, much harder to think about for me mentally than doing a singles match. So it's good. I mean, it's scary. It's like, oh god, gonna be doing a different thing, but you know, it's how you get better, I suppose, is being uncomfortable and being put in situations like that to help you improve.
And it shows how much trust that you got as well, that you've done this for the year and they've got, right, okay, you've this kind of like your reward at the end of it. And the fact that because you were such a effective good guy, or Crusher was such an effective bad guy, but somehow it's more because you were so good that he became a face at the same time because he was protecting you. So it was like, it shows how well you did that you were able to take someone like Crusher, who at the time was very much hated because he had the big feud with Scotty Swift, who's like much like Caleb's a god, but Swift is a god and wrestles in Aberdeen, that you're able to kind of take him and make him a good guy and be this lovable Christmas monster and have his tinsel around his belt and all that kind of stuff. And which is just, it definitely shows how well your character had grown. Speaking of grown, it'd been at that point, October 19, we were against the Executioner. Peterhead, I've got recorded as your last match before Halloween Hijinks, was against the Executioner again. So since then, since our first match with Executioner, you would have had things like the Halloween Hijinks, you would have had the Christmas Brawl, you would have had the tag match involving Alan Sterling. So you got a little bit more experience with comedy stuff and character stuff. Did you find that facing the Executioner again in Peterhead was just like a totally different experience because you're a bit more ready for that kind of thing?
Probably was a lot like more confident by then to, you know, do this sort of matches. But even still, probably wasn't, you know, to the point where it's just, you know, just let go and enjoy it. Because now it's like, I'd love to have a match with Super Executioner. It just sounds so fun. You know, like now, like the like current state, maybe be like, oh, I'm sure we could do something actually, you know, where I just do more, you know, to...
There's so many things you can do.
You can gaga up completely, just, you know, all the silly stuff.
So we'll take a break from the actual your career chat so far, and go, because we've got loads of questions. Most of them are unfortunately aimed at non-wrestling things. So we'll just dive in. I'll leave Omar's for that next bit. Oh god, there's so many terrible questions. And right, okay, let's dive in. Blue Thunder, he's put, have you remembered that you've got a podcast recording to do today? So this is, of course, about your already recorded terrible timekeeping. Any particular timekeeping escapades that they don't let you forget about?
Trying to think if there's... No, it's just a general... I don't mean to miss the start of training or anything like that. I mean, even for the show we just had, I was late to help like load the van and stuff. Not actually, only by a couple minutes. I'd message being like, I'm gonna be really late, and then I was only like 5-10 minutes late.
That's the key. You say you're gonna be really late and then turn up just a little bit late, and then you look great out of it. I'll just put our comment. Vago also added that I messaged you at the start of the year, but it had taken you that long for you to get back to him, get back to me. Now, this also came up in the latest Heavy Metal Mixer of your lack of responses and messages. I'm assuming it's much like myself. I'm terrible for remembering to reply to people.
The thing is, I see the messages and I'm probably doing something, and then I'm like, I'll get back to it, and then it's like, oh, it's been 4 days, crap.
By that point, you're like, that's too late now. I'll just leave it. Yeah.
But I woke up this morning and I seen Thunder's tweet, and I have never been more panicked in my life. I was like, oh my god, I've missed it. I somehow thought I was like, oh my god, like I thought he was like literally telling me it was supposed to be today, you've missed it, and I was like, oh crap.
But was that around about the time you saw it, and then that's when you messaged me going, are we still on for today? Like, it's definitely today, right? It's definitely today. So it's timekeeping. It's difficult. Scotty Swift. When is the best time to make soup, and why is it when you're drunk?
So, I know what he's referring to. I wasn't making soup though. It was like back when I was staying at Halls at like this year, probably in like April or something. Me and my flatmates had been drinking a lot, and it was like the end of the night. The end of the night, it was probably like 4 a.m. And I was like, I'm really hungry, I need to cook something. I was like, if I had something just that I could grab, I would have just grabbed it. But all I had was like burgers, and I was like, okay, I'm gonna cook burgers. And I'm never cooking while I'm drunk again, ever in my life. Because put them on, put the oil on, it was all getting hot and that. I was just like going to flip the burgers or something. Just turned around. My flatmate said something. Turned around. Just managed to spill the entire pan of burning hot oil onto my foot. Gave myself second degree burns on my foot. It was absolute agony. It was limping for weeks. Thank God we didn't have training or anything then, because I wouldn't be able to do anything. But no, that was certainly not my smartest moment.
Well, that took a turn.
Yeah.
Towards the end of that. Okay, so at least I know what you're doing while the shows are off. You were getting drunk and burning yourself. That was.
Yep.
So Ryan's sent in quite a few questions. There's some football ones, which I will look blankly at when you're answering them. Going, I have no idea what you're on about. But this is my favourite question. It might not be one you want to answer. Hi Connor, hope you're well. This is verbatim. Can you please explain why you once farted mid-nip up in a training spot we once did? Thanks.
I watch that video all the time. I think it helped. I think it helped fire me up, propelled me up. I don't know. We were going through something. We'd done it a few times, and it was this little, 15 second sequence or something, and I was roll nip up. And the exact same thing, I fart, and we're supposed to keep going, and we both just collapse in laughter because it was such a large fart, and it was exactly as soon as I landed, just couldn't stop. Thank God that didn't happen in a match. I would have just had to stall.
Oh dear. Okay, so I've got Vago. Which hurt more, being battered by Crusher in your debut at Summerhill, or completely bottling last year's WrestleZone Fantasy Football League and finishing third?
Oh, we're gonna cry. Oh, I'll take 10 chair shots before. That was really upsetting. I was top of the league with Thunder the whole of the first half of the season, and then I just forgot to keep making transfers. And
I don't know how anyone's the end time energy do that. I'm saying that, and I've got a bloody website of stupid of wrestling and results, and that consumes my life. But
I'm winning this year, though. I'm winning this happening. I mean, we're 9 weeks in. I've been top of the table every single week, and I watched that. I listened to the heavy metal mixer from that they just put out a week or something ago, or the start of the week, and because it was filmed quite a while ago, and they were can't let Connor win this year. It was just at the start of the season. And still top, so.
So another football one from Ryan Riley again. Even though West Ham had the better season last year, can you explain your feelings how the mighty Toon ruined a Champions League place for the Hammers? Thanks. Yeah, he puts thanks at the end of the questions. Quite nice.
Oh, what a polite heel. That was a very upsetting day. We had a chance to. We had a great season. That's the thing, but. Just Newcastle beat us twice that season, which really hurts because they were absolutely terrible. They're in 19th right now, so you can't say anything. So
I like that you got sober head on at this point, because again the mixer that you were on, obviously you drank a whole bottle of gin, as you confirmed. You're a bit more passionate about it, but I think that's possibly the gin that did it, and Ryan just riling you up.
I think we're the only people to ever be muted on Vegas podcast. So,
well, even Archer was kept on. Right, Martin's question, which I don't know how we're going to answer between us, but even though a football team is owned by a murderous foreign regime, why is that less shameful than being run by a podgy dwarf who sells dildos?
I don't know how to respond to that.
Yeah, I think we'll just move on from.
Martin, what's your deal with West Ham? Come on.
He's also added another question. Mark Noble is simply a poor man's Jonjo Shelby. Discuss.
I will not take this slander. I will not take this slander anywhere. What is Mark Noble and West Ham done to Martin? Mark Noble is an absolute legend of football. He is a great, well, not anymore, but he was a great midfielder. Great captain. One club man. Beautiful man.
I can tell you, when I used to play FIFA, he used to be a good transfer to get in. Quite quickly for any team. He was a rock in midfield.
He's always been a great. He should have went to the Euros in 2016. He underrated as Mark Noble.
So less wrestling and less slander of football. Scott has got best episode of Friends and why?
Oh, that is a good question, because Friends is my I think half what me and Scotty talk about is just friends, and we just send each other friends stuff all the time. I've got a few. If I had to pick one, like, I remember when I was a kid, I think my mum, I was like my favorite show even when I was like growing up, because it was lucky, because it was my mum's favorite show as well, so it's probably why I started watching it. I remember even watching it just as young as possible. She'd be like, why are you not watching like the Teletubbies? I'm watching Friends. But I think my favorite episode is probably the one where they play football, because I used to, whenever, all the time, I would just have that one on repeat. So that's probably my favorite episode.
So the one with the Cup one.
Yeah, the Geller Cup. Yeah. The one with the blackouts also good. The one with the routine, they're probably like some of my faves. But no, I think the one with the football, the last episode is also great. The end of the show in a perfect way, I think. But no, the one with the football, it's like, if I had this, like right now, if I was to go watch Friends and I had to pick just one episode to watch, that's the one I'd pick.
One I've only ever seen the once is when, I don't know what the episode's called, but it's the one where they find porn. And it's the scramble channel.
The free porn, yeah.
It's an episode. Years after I thought I'd watched all of them, it popped up on E4 in the evening, and I was going, I have never seen this episode before.
I'd love to have episodes I've not seen. I've seen them all, hundreds.
It was so weird just seeing it, because I was like, I'm sure I've seen all of them, but I've not seen this episode. They've got a scramble channel and they're not moving from it.
Strange.
But yeah, it's weird. It's nowadays people are watching it back with a 2021 mindset of going, oh, this is terrible. It's like, this was,
yeah, you have to appreciate it for the time. I mean, most things made back then are gonna have jokes that aren't socially acceptable now, but you just got to put on, you got to acknowledge the fact that it was made back then and at a different time. I'm not saying everything that is said back then was acceptable, but it was not as criticized in that for the time.
Absolutely. Now you can watch stuff now. Like, one of my favorite, guilty pleasures is the Ace Ventura films. They would never get made today. You've never seen them. It's fine. I've seen your face. But they're every phobic you can think of. They're disgusting, but they're hilarious at the same time. Same with Austin Powers. Again, probably not. It's before your time. But the last one was 2002, I think, came out. So definitely before your time. 2003.
Yeah, I was alive then, at least.
But yeah, so again, it's films that I loved, but you kind of sit back and go, yeah, I shouldn't shout for the rooftops. I love these things because they're not that great nowadays. But anyway, so yeah, Friends, good choice for episodes. And I suppose because you haven't seen Ghostbusters, it's the only thing that Scotty's maybe got in common outside of wrestling.
Yeah,
because he's a big movie guy. Right, and to kind of swing us back into wrestling, just make sure I've got no other questions before I ask it. Callum from Boom of the Banner, he asked, dream Aberdeen Anarchy match.
Oh, that's a good question. Am I just picking?
They could bring in anyone. So, Jeff Hardy.
Just
get Shawn Michaels back.
Honestly, if in history, that would be like the one person I would choose to have a match against. So, I'll answer it in like two different ways. I'll say if just anyone wrestling now, it'd be like AJ Styles. Just get him out his WWE contract for an Anarchy match. But if I was to pick just like WrestleZone guys, I think I would pick what would be fun? A ladder match. I was about to say it doesn't need to be for a title, but it's weird how you can't really have a ladder match without having it for a title. So for whatever title against, I don't know, Caleb, just because I can just imagine him hurling me through about 20 ladders.
So not to discount Chris Archer's current reign with the title, but yourself, Caleb, Tri-Counties Championship, ladder match, TLC, why not? Let's throw tables in.
Make it, or throw Ryan in there as well, and or someone, just a few bodies in for a fun ladder match for the Tri-Counties title. Throw Vigo in there as well.
Oh, Vigo loves it. They love that. Just to get a mention, and he'll politic his way to get a title. So unfortunately, not winning.
Yeah, no, I'm not winning. No, he'll somehow get me out of the match. He'll get me out of my dream match.
We'll get moved to Montrose. And go, ah, yeah. Well, I'll have to win. Oh. I know, although him and Valhalla in the same match in Montrose, I don't know how it's going to go.
I think Montrose would implode.
So we do have one more question, but we'll ask it after we get back to one question sent in, but we'll get to first show back, Halloween Hijinks 2021, when you found out that wrestling was actually coming back. First of all, how did you feel when everything was locked down? You were stuck in halls. I mean, I suppose drunk is the answer. Yeah. But how did you feel finally being told, right, we're getting back to wrestling? Are you getting back to training? Are you able to do something physical again outside of starting?
So I was so good, because obviously we got back to training for what, like 2 months, just like tail end of last year-ish. Non-contact, of course, so there's only so much you can do. It's just a lot of cardio stuff. So when we got back, like even whenever it was that we started getting back this year, by the time we had, because all I'd been doing for 7 months is sitting in halls and drinking, I was not in the best of shape. And it was, God, I looked at photos of myself in like May and I was just like grey. So like when a new training was coming back, and obviously we didn't know that shows were coming back because, you know, things could have just went back in a lockdown. But I made the decision, I was like, okay, I want to actually look good for shows come back. So I started to, when I moved back to Forest for the summer, I was like, okay, I'm going to start going to the gym, because by the time, but I'll get a couple months at least to start, try to look good for the upcoming shows, because just wanted to try and look a bit better. But no, as soon as like I heard we were actually, you know, definitely 100% getting shows back, I was absolutely buzzing. I was like, you could have put me in the ring against anyone. I think, you know, by that point I was just so ready to go, and I was like, wasn't like nervous. Like, well, of course I was nervous, because you should be a bit nervous, but I wasn't like petrified of like having a match like I used to be. I was like, feel confident, just in myself more as a person, I guess, in general. So I was just like, I'm ready to go out and have fun for once.
Did you find changing your name, your surname anyway, did it help create more of a character? As in, before you were just you, whereas now Connor Molloy is now, that is your in-ring persona, that is your character.
Yeah, so you can put yourself into it. I think it might have something to do with that, with creating a bit of a distinction between the two. Of course, I don't have like, you know, a massive gimmick or anything, but I do just want, like, well, I am just now going out there. Well, I'll say all the time, it's just that one match so far, but hopefully for the future as well, just going out there and just being myself, but just, you know, the old adage of, you know, just turning it up to 11 or whatever, and just having fun, because I think that's what I've like realized recently, is like wrestling's supposed to be fun. Like, should just have fun while we're doing it. Like, you know, it doesn't have to be like super serious. Of course, I want to go out there and do well, but like the audience is gonna have fun if I'm having fun, mm-hmm. for the most part, you know, without, you know, just taking the mickey.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's kind of trying to drag that line of having fun but respecting what you're doing at the same time. But so yeah, we're on to the match, which is, actually, no, I'll ask my two really stupid questions and then we'll just get into the match, and that kind of is a nice way to kind of round up the show. We ask everyone, you've already said that you've been preparing or trying to. You might not have, you might have forgotten. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Oh, there's an episode of Friends where there's a made-up dinosaur called the Embosco Dictyosaurus. So I'll say that.
See, I thought when you said Friends, it was going to be that or Ross doing an impression of a Velociraptor. Yeah. Which I missed off my top 100 dinosaurs list, and I'm absolutely gutted by it. I'm going to do it, redo it. The other question we ask everyone, what would win in the fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow. 100%.
Like the confidence, that's fine. We'll just go with that. before we move on to your last match as of recording, we've mentioned the mosh pit quite a lot, which I like to think it's like, that really, that cousin that your parents don't like to have come over, but they have to sometimes, you know, in comparison to this podcast. Like, I do like a straight lace, ask the wrestling questions, then they go on to mosh pit and get drunk and just have a whale of a time, but they always kind of regret some bits of it the next day. Yes. What was it like the next morning? Did you have to hope that you hadn't said anything particularly outrageous, or what was your immediate thoughts after the mosh pit?
I messaged Vigo the next day saying I apologize if I got too drunk, but because I still haven't finished watching it, because listening to myself get drunk, I got up until the last 50 minutes to watch, and I just can't watch it. I turn it on and I'm just like, I'm so drunk, and I just like, I'm doing it now. I do have a problem where I just say like all the time, and Dino pointed out, like, it's like if you took a sip every time you said like, we'd be steaming. I was like, apparently there's one part where I'm just going like I just like stuttering to saying it like 9 times in a row, but I'm very glad that I was not the drunkest on it, so I did not look as bad.
And I think we've got a new champion of the heavy metal mixer drinkathon, with Vago abandoning his own podcast.
Yeah, that
an
was
hour left.
Amazing.
Oh, it's incredible. It's the fact I listened to it first, so I didn't see him disappear.
Oh, no, yeah. He specifically told me you need to watch this one, not listen to it.
Yeah, you need to, because he sounded okay, and then I watched it back, and there was like halfway through, and he started just dipping down. Oh my god.
Yeah.
He did very well to at least sound alive for another half an hour or so before he died. Well done, Vago. You probably get that's the biggest laugh I've had.
I said to him, I want to somehow try and overtake him for getting the drunkest, but I don't know how I'd do that. I just need to start taking shots immediately.
You just need to just come on absolutely blazing to start off with.
Beforehand, and then that's the thing, is when we started that one, I was already like quite tipsy, because we'd had like Vago had had to like go put his kids down or something. There was something with his kids, and then like I had technical issues, and then there was just like technical issues, and it was like over an hour like after we were supposed to start recording, like maybe like nearly an hour and a half. So I'm just drinking my, I was about to say wine, drinking my gin. I already had a few glasses by the time we started, and I remember like, because you know he doesn't pay for the full thing of Zoom, so it's like every 50 minutes you get kicked out, and it was like 50 minutes, and I was in for this, and I just went to the bathroom, and Mum was like, oh, how's it going? I was like, oh yeah, it's going all right. She was like, you drunk? I was like, I am actually quite drunk, and we're going to be still recording for like 2 more hours. This is great. She was like, maybe slow down. No.
But no, I mean, like I said, I'm not one to judge at all, because I had 2 beers and I was just done. I was getting the old gun out and shooting all over the place, and just calling every company I don't like under the sun just the worst things, because I didn't care. I had 2 Coronas and I was just like, ah. No one's gonna listen to me anyway.
I think I was actually worse when we went out after the Halloween show that we just had, because I do not remember leaving the pub, because you know the pub was open till 6 in the morning because there was a boxing on, and I like I'd woke up at like the day before at like 7 p.m. like my sleep pattern's just awful, so by the time we had our match, like I'd been awake for a full day because I just couldn't sleep. So then by the time we were drinking, like I'd been awake for like a day and a half, and I thought I left at like 3:30, but I only found out like last night that I stayed until like the end. So I was like, I don't remember like 3 hours of that night. I must have just, apparently I was just up at the bar just like telling Scott. I was just like, I just love all you guys so much. I was just like,
No.
I know, I was like, oh, why? Well, at least I was a happy drunk. And
that's the best one to be. I'm a fall asleep and throwing up drunk. I'm the worst of, I'm not the worst, violent, obviously. I'm in the middle somewhere of, it's quite funny, but I really don't hope I'd have taken back to a hotel room, because he's just going to throw up everywhere, which unfortunately has happened. Anyway, speaking about Halloween hijinks, you've segued beautifully into our last little bit, and then we'll
that's all on purpose.
Exactly. It's like we plan these things.
I've got my notes right here.
So Halloween hijinks, you got the match. The question that I've got that I was leaving for was from Omar Mohammed. He's just asked, at the time, it's been over a week and I'm still wondering how your chops hurt more than Crusher's. Please explain how. Was that just because you were amped up to just be wrestling again?
I think it was like when because I got tagged in, Crusher was holding them, and I just felt every so much adrenaline and just laid it in thick, apparently. But I don't know. But that's quite something though, because I've taken a lot of Crusher's chops and I know they do hurt. So I don't know. It must have just been the full adrenaline and a year and a half out of just built up energy going through that one chop.
It was very much a welcome back to WrestleZone for Omar. Just chop. I will say, because I don't think I said it in the review show, but my wife, for those that are unaware, I was very impressed between your and Omar's like interactions and just how crisp it was. And I asked him about it, and he's just like, no, I think that was the first time we'd pretty much done anything.
So
it's definitely.
I think we'd been together at training like once before that, and we didn't even really do anything then.
So I think it's very much. I know he's kind of got a little thing going on with the out. Well, Ted O'Keefe anyway. But I wouldn't say no to revisiting. Yourself and Omar down the line. So yeah, first match in. You loved it clearly because you had this so much character and charisma and energy. And like you said, you built up so much confidence. It's almost like you had to have it taken away for to realize how much you were like. How much of yourself you'd put into it.
Yeah, I think as well, like the last couple matches that I had before the first lockdown, I just wasn't happy with how I was doing, I guess. And I think I don't know if I would have just continued to be annoyed with myself afterwards, but I don't wish there was lockdown. It was a bit of a crap year and a half. But just in terms of like taking that time away and I don't know. I feel like I just like since like, you know, the start of the first lockdown and going back to shows, I just feel like a completely different person. I don't know if it's like just, you know, moving away to Aberdeen and becoming independent or just much more confident in myself and, you know, just from meeting new people and doing new things and all that sort of stuff. But no, I just really enjoyed being out there for once.
That's probably it. It's probably because you spent that lockdown time just either in a bubble with your roommates or you find more opportunities to go out, and because you're old enough to actually go out, you're able to go out and just interact with people and make friends, even if it's alcohol induced, and you're finding your voice and able to kind of interact with people. And then you take it to WrestleZone, who everyone was just amped up. I didn't realize how much I missed it until the first match happened, or until Mr. Malice came out, and I was like, oh my god, I can't imagine how much.
My favorite part of the show was him hitting that cannonball. I didn't know he'd done it until I was watching it back, and I was like, oh, that was amazing.
It's just I didn't realize how much I missed it, and I can't imagine how much you guys missed. Just absolutely. I'm assuming it's probably one of the stiffest nights when it comes to shots and chops and kicks and everything like that, because everyone will just be so amped up, like, oh, this is it.
Probably. I was really amped up as well, because it's the first time I'd had my mum come to watch like a couple matches before, but it's the first time I had any of my friends come to watch, and I had quite a few friends there in the audience. So that was I purposely, when I was like making my entrance, I was like, I don't want to see them, whatever they are, I don't want to see them, because I feel like I'll just get more nervous if I see them. But then I seen them, like, and I was like, oh, it just made me more amped up, and I was like, oh, they're here to support me. Well, I just felt better when I seen them. And even like I had like quite a few friends there, and then I had one of my friends from home and his friend like come and watch and surprise me. I just seen them and I was like, oh, I didn't know they were coming. It was great. But it was just such a fun night. Like, I think everyone in the audience, I think everyone that was wrestling staff and everyone, it was just a fun, good night of wrestling.
Of course, you didn't so much debut a new look, but you had your hair dyed, you had muscles, which, I mean, I couldn't remember last time I seen you. It would have been that Battle of Nations, and I was looking going, Jesus, Connor's got himself into some shape. I was just like, amazed. It's just like, Christ, he actually looks like a man now, in the weirdest possible sense. But I don't know if it's just because you did look so much in shape, and then Crusher came out and he was just this massive beast, and he had his head shaved, which I hadn't seen other than over Zoom, and it was still a little bit a boy and his dad, but you know.
I don't think that's going to change. That'll be our tag name, a boy and his dad.
Well, you don't have a tag team name, so maybe that's it. There was another name that I can't say because it's a terrible name that popped out. Yeah, and I
can imagine what you're going to say.
I think it might be on the K&K Wrestle Factory. I'll just let people just go there and hear it, because they came out with a name. Anyway.
I've had friends say similar things, and I'm like, nope.
It's funny in the moment. but not as a team name. Right, so that's it. That's your career. That's where we're all started. That's it. Yeah, only took an hour and a half. So, which again, in considering it's only technically been a year and a half of in-ring stuff, you've packed a lot in during that time.
Yeah.
Tag team champion at the moment. Is there any thoughts about trying to go elsewhere, like to Discovery or anything like that? Is there any promotions or opponents outside of WrestleZone that you've been able to see and be like, oh, I think we could do some good stuff with them?
Yeah, so definitely want to, you know, venture out into other places. Not looking actually at the minute. I'm more just focusing on improving myself at training, getting a few matches back under my belt at, you know, wrestles on shows, and hitting the gym to make sure I look good if I was to go anywhere else. So that's like start of next year, you know, a wee bit into the start of next year, I'll start really thinking about it and looking to try and venture out. But for right now, I'm quite content and just trying to improve to feel confident enough in myself to, when I do that, know that I'm not going to be worried if I show up to somewhere and, you know, have to put a match together and do all this and work in front of a different crowd and meet new people and all that sort of stuff. But I think by the, like, you know, not too long into next year, but I'll be ready and willing to do that. I'm sure I'm ready enough now, just get a few shows under my belt, start next year, start fresh and try and get out there.
Well, so yeah, we'll keep the list under wraps where you're hoping to get it, just to see how it goes.
Yeah, just not anything too much. I don't like planning, just in general. It's probably why I'm late for everything. I don't like planning too far in the future. So we'll just see what happens, to be honest.
So yeah, before we wrap up then, were you able to pass on any little bit of advice to Evan Young after? Because of course that was his first night. So you've, a year and a half ago or so, you were in that same position of getting the big reaction afterwards. Were you able to kind of have a word with him and just maybe not even quell his expectations, or at least just tell him like what you'd learned after your first couple appearances and what you could possibly do?
No, I never really got to have a chat with him or anything about that. I gave, like, you know, quickly, just before he was about to go out, you know, I just gave him a wee, you know, just enjoy it sort of thing, which, because I never, whenever, you know, it's just like, so like, God, what's happening? But the thing is, you could tell when he watched him, he actually enjoyed it, which you can tell, and it makes a big difference. But no, he's really good. So, yeah, and he enjoyed himself and he done really well. That's the thing. And I'd seen him in the weeks like leading up to, like, you know, practice and stuff and training, and it's like, oh, he's ready, you know, throw him out there, he's ready. So
maybe a match next year as well. Right, so where can people find you on social media?
Social media, me,
you just joined the Twitterverse.
I know, I just joined Twitter and like just started using Instagram as well, because me and social media, that's probably why I'm just so bad at replying to everyone. But I think both Instagram and Twitter are Connor Molloy 19, and then Facebook's just Connor Molloy.
This is simple, that's fine. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. But
no, thank you.
We had a good time. I mean, we started a little bit later than anticipated, but I think I should have known that from your reputation somehow precedes you. But no, that was a fantastic time. Thanks for taking time.
Thank you so much.